My name's Caroline Noakes. I'm Member of Parliament for Romsey and Southampton North and also a member of the Speaker's Advisory Committee on Works of Art, which I have... I was going to say I've done that for 5 years since I was elected, but that would be actually false. And one of the things that struck me when I was first asked to join the committee was that it took a while after the general election to reconstitute the committee. And that's not a failure on anyone's part, it's just a happening of circumstance in this place. But something that many of us are very concerned about post-2015 is that we have to make sure that the committee is reconstituted as swiftly as possible so that we can crack on with some of the excellent work that has already been done. International Women's Day is an important moment to reflect on women's achievements and the issues which affect women. This year, as part of Parliament's events, we have the Women in Parliament Works from the Parliamentary Art Collection exhibition on display. This exhibition documents women's engagement with, and I think it's important to emphasise that because obviously women had an impact on this place long before they were ever elected. So it's their engagement with and achievements in Parliament since the 1780s. Today we are also very pleased to be launching the associated publication. I have one of these to wave at you. It makes me feel slightly like an air hostess. And before you all leave, they are on the tables at either side of the room. Please do take one. It documents the collection and is absolutely fascinating to read and perhaps look at the works of art in conjunction with it. I would like to take this opportunity to thank Una Gay of the House of Commons Library and Mari Takianagi, I managed to get that one out, of the Parliamentary Archives, and of course Melanie, who is from the Curator's Office and has been a fantastic support and I would like to say real driving force between our commitment to get more women represented in the collection. I very much enjoyed looking at the exhibition and it's been very inspiring and affirming to see the many portraits of past women MPs and to reflect on their achievements and how they have changed our society. We do have some obvious gaps in our collections and those have been caused by nothing more sinister than historic circumstance, but we are committed to trying to find portraiture of the missing and significant women to fill those gaps. And it's something that I think it's critically important that we are brave enough to embrace publicity around the women's collection. Say, actually, look, there are some gaps. We would love to find portraits of significant women that we simply don't have in the collection. And so while sometimes members are a little reluctant to talk about art in this place, and particularly sometimes the media try and pick holes in our commitment to art, I think from a historic perspective, it is so important to be brave enough to talk about it, to promote it, and hopefully to highlight to those people who might know where some of the hidden women are, to come forward and let us know. It is perhaps then appropriate that the subject of this evening's lecture is Irene Ward, a Member of Parliament who contested her first election in 1924, when she was still too young to vote for herself. And she subsequently served as an MP for nearly 38 years. Ward is one of the significant women of whom there is no known portrait, but please be assured we keep searching. But before we hear more about Irene Ward, I'm delighted to introduce our first speaker this evening, Eleanor Laing MP. Eleanor was appointed Deputy Speaker, officially the first Deputy Chairman of Ways and Means, in 2013, and she is only the sixth woman to have ever held that position. We are delighted that she has agreed to give the introductory talk to this year's lecture. Eleanor.
Well, thank you very much, Caroline, and good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's wonderful to be here talking about something as inspiring as the art collection, rather than what is going to be in our party manifesto over the next few months. Parliament is a wonderful place. It isn't only about politics and policies and arguments and speeches and rhetoric. It is also the best institution that our country has, and I would argue, but I won't start to argue now, that it's one of the best institutions the world has ever known, this Parliament here at Westminster, that has been here in one form or another for 750 years, in one form or another since historical anniversaries committee. I get my committees mixed up. That's one of those. So many different ones. Now we're doing art. The anniversaries committee celebrated in this very room the 750th anniversary of the Simon de Montfort Parliament just a few weeks ago, and a few weeks after that, in leading up to June 2015, we will be celebrating the 800th anniversary of Magna Carta. It all comes together, celebrating freedom and democracy. And I honestly believe that our iconic Parliament building here is an internationally renowned symbol of that freedom and democracy that is so important to us, and that around the world today we see in countries that don't have freedom and don't have democracy how much help they need from us and how much they look to us as leaders of the free world, one of the leaders of the free world, to keep reminding people how important it is to uphold democracy. And in doing so, I think it's terribly important that we don't only look at the political events and issues that are before us today, 2015. It's terribly important that we appreciate sometimes, in some form or another, the linear history of which we are part. And I do believe that the Women in Parliament Parliamentary Art Collection and all that it stands for and all that we've been talking about today is a very important part of that historical progression, and also an important part of preserving people's understanding of where we came from and where we're going to. Because unless you know where we came from, you cannot guide where we're going to. And I'm sorry to hear that there aren't portraits of Irene Ward. I'm sure you'll find one somewhere now that the word has gone out. But nowadays we're much better at that, and the Arts Committee has been brilliant at it. On the front page of this lovely magazine, you see the great new portrait of my colleague, the other Deputy Speaker, Dawn Primorolo. It is, everybody look at it. It's there. You all got it. It's a brilliant portrait. It was also unveiled in this very room not long ago. She's actually much prettier than that, and she does sometimes smile. I know it's thought when you're Deputy Speaker and in the chair and being stern and calling order, order, and keeping people in order and under control, that smiling is not the order of the day. So that's Dawn looking very professional indeed. But she does sometimes smile as well. The important thing is that we celebrate and remember people who represent different parts of our democracy. And in considering women in Parliament, there are always certain questions that I am asked, and one of them is, so who was your role model? And of course, in my case, there's a terribly simple answer to that, which is terribly obvious. So this evening, I'm not going to give you the obvious answer. The obvious answer is Margaret Thatcher. There are lots and lots of portraits of Margaret Thatcher and lots of books about Margaret Thatcher. And she was a wonderful reformer and a fantastic role model for women. And I'm sorry, am I being heckled there?
Yes.
Well, I don't expect everybody to agree with me, but I'm sorry, madam, but I'll choose my role models and you can choose yours. the great thing that Margaret Thatcher did is that she made it impossible for people to say to women of my generation and those coming afterwards, you can't do it because you're a woman. And that's what people said. I remember at school being asked, at the stage that my son is at now in choosing his GCSEs, what do you want to be? And I said I had an interest in politics, and they said, oh yes, there. Do you want to be a doctor or a lawyer or a teacher? And nobody took it seriously. After Margaret Thatcher and others of her generation, other brilliant women like Shirley Williams and Barbara Castle and others who are still here in Parliament, who are great role models to all of us, nobody can say you can't do it because you're a woman. But I wanted to tell you about my real role model. Because when I was a very little girl, our Member of Parliament at home in East Renfrewshire, which is to the west of Glasgow and the west coast of Scotland, was Betty Harvey Anderson. Now, this is a genuine question. Who has heard of Betty Harvey Anderson? Hands up. Yeah, just a few. Well, Betty Harvey Anderson was the MP for East Renfrewshire for 20 years or so. And I knew her because I had been introduced to her by my father, and she came to our house, so I knew what an MP was when I was 10 years old. I knew what an MP was, and it was a lady with her grey hair up in a bun who spoke to me in a very similar way that my headmistress at school spoke to me. So I knew that that's what an MP was. To me, an MP was not a man in a three-piece suit who said, there, dear. It was a lady who was very determined and sure of herself. And Betty Harvey Anderson ought to be better remembered because she was the first woman ever to sit in the Speaker's chair. She was the first Deputy Speaker of the House of Commons to be a woman. When she was appointed Deputy Speaker, the House addressed her as Mr. Deputy Speaker because it didn't occur to them to call her Madam Deputy Speaker. That had never been done before. You didn't do things that weren't done before. So they called her Mr. Deputy Speaker. I think eventually they called her Madam Deputy Speaker. And she was my role model. And I believe it's terribly important that we tell future generations that women take their part in the system of freedom and democracy in our free country every bit as much as men do. And because there are more role models in history who happen to be men, makes it all the more important that the work that we are doing in a meeting like this tonight highlights the role that women play here in Parliament. The second question I'm always asked is, has Parliament changed? Is it different because there are more women? And the answer is yes. I've been a Member of Parliament for 18 years, so I came in 1997 when we had that huge influx of women, and that made a big difference. I worked here for a cabinet minister before I was elected, so I know how this place felt when there were very few women around, and I know how it feels now that there is a critical mass of women. Of course we need more, and we're all working towards that. Always, most of us here in Parliament have been working very hard for decades to try to have more women elected on all political fronts. But there is a big difference, because while you only have a handful of women, then making the woman's voice heard is very much more difficult. And the culture of the place is different when there aren't a significant number of women. Now, it depends what you call a significant number. I've never been particularly bothered that there should be 50%, but at the moment we're still around only 20%. If we can increase the number of women in Parliament to around 30%, it stops being an issue, because then there are enough women to do all the jobs that need to be done. I can remember on International Women's Day about 15 years ago, we had a debate, of course, on women's issues. Now we have to fight for them. in front of the Backbench Business Committee, but over these last 5 years, we have succeeded in front of the Backbench Business Committee in obtaining a debate on women on or near International Women's Day. But 15 years ago, we had a debate on International Women's Day, and on the then government side, there was a significant number of women, not huge, but significant. And I was on the opposition side, along with my then colleague, Julie Kirkbride. And there were just two of us, and someone at the dispatch box. There were just two of us. So we started off sitting on the third and fourth row above the gangway. And then after about half an hour, one of us moved to another position, and then the other moved to a different position. And we spent the whole afternoon moving round the chamber so that as we were caught on camera, it would look as if there were more of us. I kid you not. I kid you not. What an awful thing to have to resort to, actually moving round the chamber to try to make it look as if there were more of you. I was ashamed back then that there weren't more people, both men and women, supporting International Women's Day. But things have changed very significantly these last 18 years, very significantly, and the current generation of men no longer laugh at a debate on International Women's Day. And it is terribly important that we take forward the place of women in our national life and in our democratic system. Women from all parts of the political spectrum, because it simply isn't fair to shout down any person because of their beliefs or what they stand for or what they say. And if you jeer at Margaret Thatcher, I wouldn't have people jeer at Nelson Mandela or at Harold Wilson or at anyone else with whom I disagree, because the reason for standing here and the reason for being here in a free and democratic system is that everyone has the right of free speech to stand up for what they believe in. And then we bring these beliefs and ideas to Parliament. We discuss them, we argue about them, we vote upon them, we make laws, and that's what democracy is all about. And the more that we have women involved in our free democratic system, the better that system will be. And I believe that women and the role of women should be promoted in every way possible. And Mary Branson's Mary Branson's wonderful sculpture, which I gather, I'm sorry I wasn't here earlier because I was doing other duties, I gather you have had a very good presentation on it. Isn't it wonderful?
Yes. Yes.
And it's going to have a very prominent place in the Houses of Parliament. It's going to have a prominent place. And every time people look at it, we will remember that women fought to give us the freedom of speech, the vote, and the right to sit in this wonderful Parliament that represents freedom. And let us go on promoting the role of women and all that we can do for freedom and democracy. Thank you.
I hope nobody noticed a slight panic there that Eleanor had taken my words, which could have been very serious indeed. I'd just like to say a huge thank you to Eleanor for having come along this evening. Wonderful words, and for somebody like me who really is just starting out on their parliamentary career, you can say that in this place, having been here 5 years, that it's really just the beginning. Eleanor certainly is a fantastic role model herself and an inspiration, and wonderful, I think, to have two women deputy speakers at the moment. And certainly in the chamber, it brings a different tone, although she is quite right. When Dawn gives you the look, you certainly sit down and shut up. So, on to the main business of this evening. Our speaker is Helen Langley. She is a historian and a curator, and until her recent retirement was the manuscript curator at the Bodleian Library. For many years, her research focused mainly on the private papers of public figures, including notably Benjamin Disraeli and the politician and journalist Honor Balfour, the first president of the Liberal Club at Oxford. Helen is a contributor to the Oxford Dictionary of National Biography, including, importantly, the entry on Irene Ward. There will be an opportunity at the end of the lecture for questions, but I would just like to hand over this evening to Helen Langley.
Thank you very much. It is a great privilege and pleasure to deliver the 2015 Speakers Advisory Committee on Works of Art International Women's Day Lecture, for Westminster was, for over 40 years, Dame Irene's true home. And here we see her in later life, her youthful stylishness transmuted into large hats and capacious handbags. Irene Mary Buick Ward, still most usually referred to as Dame Irene, despite her later peerage, was a vigorous champion of the underdog and a diligent constituency MP with a high national profile. One of the foremost figures in the first wave of women MPs, in her parliamentary career, she outlasted all her contemporaries. She fervidly believed in the backbencher's duty to scrutinise and, whenever necessary, harry governments, including their own. As a backbencher, she successfully introduced 4 private members' bills and campaigned for over 15 years for women's equal pay. On her retirement from the Commons in February 1974, she was the longest-serving woman MP. That was overtaken later by Gwyneth Dunwoody, but I think she still holds the record for introducing 4 private members' bills. And yet much of this is forgotten today. Partly this is due to the passage of time, but also perhaps because in her later years, she became something of a character. The British love eccentrics, and Dame Irene was a larger-than-life figure. Sometimes, though, in her later years, her political judgment about which issues to adopt and how to pursue them lacked proportionality and subtlety. One thinks of certain exchanges with heads of public organisations. She may have revelled in the sobriquet Tory battle axe and Whitehall warrior, and the varying mixes of affection and exasperation she attracted as Dame Irene being Dame Irene. But she risked becoming a caricature of herself. That said, her understanding of the Westminster process remained profound. She knew how to exploit it to publicise her cause. This afternoon's lecture revisits some of the key stages in Dame Irene's life. It draws mainly on her private papers, those of the Equal Pay Campaign Committee, and printed sources, rather than official records, other than those quoted in publications. Hopefully, the files in the National Archives contain a full account of Dame Irene's exchanges with ministers. Returning to her papers for this lecture, I was struck by the omissions. There's far more incoming than outgoing correspondence. There are few copies of the latter. There's no memoir or detailed journal other than some from travels. In old age, she gave a couple of lengthy interviews. When, in the late 1990s, I was researching her life for Oxford Dictionary of National Biography, I found she had a walk-on part in several books, The Papers of Lady Astor, and some organisational archives. Not much more has been written about her since. So despite her early high-profile life and later colourful image, there's something of an elusive quality to Dame Irene. What shines through, though, and it's well captured in photographs, is enthusiasm for life and for politics. Dame Irene was renowned for her independence, tenacity, and courage, characteristics which owe much to her experience growing up in what we might now call genteel poverty. Her widowed mother's small income managed by male in-laws. Alfred Buick Ward, he was related to the family that produced the great 18th century engraver Thomas Buick, moved from the north to practice as an architect in London, where he contributed to the designs of the mosaics for the new Westminster Cathedral. He and Alvina progressed from a flat in St. Stephen's Mansions, where Irene was born, to a house, 33 The Avenue in Bedford Park. Everything looked set fair, but in 1901, disaster struck. He became ill and died. Irene was just 5 years old. And here we see Irene with her mother, Alvina. And here, slightly later, and I think probably after her father had died, she's not looking too happy. Over the next few years, money was an issue. I don't know how much Alvina and Irene had to live on, or the extent of the Ward brothers' contribution to the overall amount. But from evidence in Dame Irene's private papers, now catalogued and held in the Bodleian Library, Oxford, it's clear the relations were fraught at times. Bewick Ward's will contained precise instructions for his daughter's education, but no funds to pay for it. The four Ward uncles rejected the original choice of local schooling, the charitable Freemason school, lest it implied that the family couldn't afford to pay for Irene's education. So she was sent to Newcastle Church High School for Girls. With one of her uncles paying for their accommodation, they eventually settled in Gosforth, a suburb of Newcastle. To complicate matters, the four Ward uncles appear to have disagreed between themselves over the release of funds to their sister-in-law and niece. In 1916, shortly after coming of age, Irene threatened to sue her uncle, Percy Ward, an accountant, for non-payment of a relatively moderate sum, £5, 4 shillings and fourpence, that's about £225 in recent money. And he may have been the most active and supportive of the four trustees. But by 1921, when it was agreed to sell some Thomas Bewick blocks, relations appear to have improved. Although Irene didn't dwell in public on these past experiences, they must have left their mark. When she wrote to ministers or rose in the House to speak on behalf of widows, pensioners, and others living on small incomes, she knew something of the realities they faced. Throughout her career, she was mindful of those whose, quote, hard luck had been harder than my own, unquote. Despite a limited income, Mrs. Ward was determined that Irene should have elocution and dancing lessons. They regularly went to the theatre, the cheaper seats, of course, to see great actors or dancers, like the ballerina Pavlova on tour, or hear speakers on contemporary issues, like Mrs. Pankhurst on women's suffrage. Irene developed a taste for amateur dramatics, performing initially in school productions. And here we have her, possibly in a Shakespeare production. She played Catherine in Taming the Shrew and Cordelia in King Lear. Oops, that's an advanced one. Irene had ambitions to be a writer. In 1906, when she was 11, a couple of her very short stories about pets had been published in the local press in Aunt Judy's column. Instead, she began her paid working life in 1912. Her first actual job may have been as a voluntary secretary in the local branch of the Royal National Lifeboat Institution. Her first paid job was as secretary to J.T. Inskip, vicar in nearby Jesmond. On her departure in October 1915, he wrote, with some prescience, "You have great promise on doing well in life, and I shall watch your career with much interest." According to a 1931 Daily Mail article by Lady Alexandra Haig, between 1915 and 1921, Irene, keen to enter social service, worked at the Newcastle Food Office. Judging from a letter she received with her 21st birthday congratulations in 1916, she was also for a time acting as a hospital secretary. Irene was also working as a voluntary aid detachment, VAD nurse, with St. John's Ambulance Brigade, something she'd started to do while still at school. And it was in this role that she made her first public speech. Deputising for her boss, Colonel Claude Palmer, who'd forgotten about the engagement and the supper, and addressing the stretcher bearers bound for the front. And here we see Irene as a VAD. And here she is
roughly the same time, second left. So she was quite daring. In an interview with Norman Welsh, a journalist, in July 1972, Dame Irene described herself as a flitter. When I was a girl, I flitted from one interest to another. So when I got the sack from War's End, that's the 1945 general election, I was determined to stick to it, if only to prove to myself and my friends that I could do it. I was also fascinated by Parliament and obsessed with the urge to fight the North's cause in Westminster. In this same interview, Dame Irene reflected that the political seed may have been sown as a poll clerk in the 1918 general election. She met and later became good friends with Sir George Rennick, the Conservative candidate for Newcastle Central, and his wife, Lady Rennick. The local Conservatives had just embarked on enrolling the newly enfranchised women over 30 years old. Irene was invited to become the honorary secretary of the Newcastle Central Conservative Women's Association. She was also finding her feet as a speaker, having recently won a speaking competition. Her initial choice of topic had been foreign affairs, but when she tried this out on Sir Cecil Cochrane, he told her she sounded like an overstrained curate. Cochrane, an industrialist and colliery owner, who'd served as a Liberal MP for South Shields between 1916 and 18, is one of the few key male figures in Dame Irene's life. Born in 1869, he was 16 years older. He spotted her potential while she was working for him. Somewhat oddly, he and his wife offered to adopt Irene. It was through visiting his factories and collieries that she acquired the knowledge of northeastern industries that informed her first campaign as an MP in 1924. And it was he who provided a car for her use on the trail around the towns and colliery villages of the Morpeth constituency. Many years later, a journalist suggested that she had converted him to her Tory views. But whether she did or not, he continued to underwrite some of her political expenses until she entered the House, and for a while after, including providing a car until 1950. Finances aside, this important friendship lasted until his death in 1960. Morpeth was Dame Irene's second attempt at standing for Parliament. In 1923, she'd attracted the notice of the party leadership when she moved her area's resolution during the Plymouth Conference. Overcome with nerves after a good delivery, she ran back to her seat, but she didn't lose her taste for politics, quite the opposite. She wanted to stand as an MP. But convincing constituency parties to accept her, an unmarried woman of 28, not yet eligible to vote, was initially difficult. An approach in November 1923 to the Wansbeck division was rebuffed by Conservative supporters living in Whitley Bay. Sir Alexander Leith advised her not to take the rejection personally. From the first to last, the only objection had been raised is that you are a woman. And 9 out of 10 people at a small private meeting last night did not know you and certainly had not heard you speak. A letter for Conservative Central Office advising her not to be put off at first attempt was swiftly followed by one from Sir Lee McLachlan, the chief organising agent, promising to find her a constituency if he could. He admired her plucky response. Such support from Conservative HQ for women candidates was by no means the norm, but it wasn't an empty gesture. In July 1924, McLachlan wrote privately to the chairman of Morpeth Constituency Party, pledging that Central Office would pay Irene Ward's election expenses if they adopted her as their prospective parliamentary candidate. Now, the chances of her winning were, of course, nil, but she took her place among 41 women candidates drawn from all parties, up from 15 in 1918. The constituency centred on Morpeth, historically a market town north of Newcastle. Agriculture, mining and shipbuilding were the main sources of employment, and it was in the colliery towns and villages that Dame Irene's mettle was most tested. Described by the Daily Express as the girl with the pretty face, distinguishing her from the two other women candidates standing in the northeast, described as an actress and a widow,
Irene may have appeared an easy target for the miners, angered by their pay and conditions, and most were in no mood to vote Conservative. In his book, Woman on the March, John Slate cites instances where miners tried to shout her down and threatened to throw her through the window. In another, chairs were thrown from the balcony. She was more at risk when she accepted a blithe communist miner's challenges to go to accompany him down the pit. Remember that Irene is quite tall, and think how small the underground corridors can be. Unknown to her, he'd organised for shots to be fired to dislodge coal, but she didn't turn back. In Morpeth, she fell through a barrel while standing on it, but that may have been an accident. And not all miners were hostile, and not all her speaking engagements ended so dramatically. She was invited into some of their homes to play chess. And as she recalled in the 1977 interview, she found her ballroom dancing skills useful in the campaign. One anonymous supporter sent this verse to her at a meeting in Blythe on the 24th of October, 5 days ahead of the election. Success to you, Miss Irene Ward. You're bright and brave to risk it. You're educated, spick and span, intelligent and able. So come in crowds and send her up to be a pal for Mabel. That was Mabel Phillipson, the MP for Berwick, the said former actress. Her election slogan was, by voting the Conservative candidate, you ward off disaster. Her election publicity embodied the views and interests she would later spend nearly 40 years promoting. I hold progressive views on the needs of social reform in relation to housing, equal housing, its improvement and abolition of slums, education, equal opportunity for all sections of the community, old age pensions, eliminate penalties for thrift and improve the present state of pensions, widows' pensions, widows left with young children should be provided for, ex-servicemen, more should be done to forward their interests. Remember, this is the early post-First World War years. She also highlighted the needs of agriculture, the grave problems of unemployment in the mining industry, and the importance of trade revival, safeguarding industries like shipbuilding and relations with the dominions and colonies. But, as expected, she lost to the sitting member, Robert Smiley, a miners' leader. But she'd won the respect of many, including miners, for her courage and her genuine interest in their lives. Undeterred by defeat, was Dame Irene really a quitter and a flitter? She remembers being, she nursed the constituency through to the 1929 general election. During the intervening years, her value to the Conservatives increased. She was a well-regarded speaker, not just in the Northeast, but further afield. In May 1925, the NUCA had formed a new parliamentary area committee for Cumberland, Durham, Northumberland and Westmorland, which would include a women's committee, providing further scope for usefulness. This and other party work are possibly the source of several unidentified group photographs in Dame Irene's papers. And here we have Dame Irene, cloche hatted, centre of front row with a baby on her knee. Who everybody else is, I have absolutely no idea. Speaking engagements also took her overseas. In October 1925, she visited Canada under the auspices of the Empire Parliamentary Association, with hospitality provided by the National Council of Education. By 1927, her reputation as a speaker was such that she was invited by the NUCA Women's Unionist Organization to second the vote of thanks to the Prime Minister at a mass meeting in Albert Hall in May. Now, this is an undated image, possibly of the event, but definitely featuring Stanley Baldwin. His reforms of the party's organisation also made it possible for candidates like Irene to be adopted. Locally, her repertoire of speeches included international affairs. In the same year, 1927, she spoke in the Morpeth constituency at a branch of the League of Nations Union at Guidepost, close by Choppington Colliery. In 10 years' time, she herself would be a government delegate to the League of Nations and win praise for the work she did there.
In 1929, the so-called flapper election, she was one of 69 women candidates, up from 41, put up by the parties, and one of 10 Conservatives. Central office may have increased her budget for the campaign. Her electoral address, now run to 2 pages, illustrated with reproductions from 9 of the Conservative Party's election posters. Her 4 points again focused on housing and slum clearance, but this time adding that new houses should be affordable rents and large families shouldn't be disqualified. Education and the coal, shipbuilding and agricultural industries were highlighted. The extension of local government health services to poor areas, especially maternity services, were added as priorities. Only 3 Conservative women candidates won seat in the election which brought the Labour Party to power, and Irene was not one of them. This is her annotated newspaper cutting with her defeat. Accepting that Morpeth was unwinnable, she looked for another seat. Dame Irene has been described as one of the women Conservative candidates who rose through their work from the party organisation in the wake of 1918's partial enfranchisement and the drive to capture women's votes. Florence Horsburgh, with whom she's often compared, was another beneficiary. In 1929, Irene was awarded a CBE for her political services, quite an achievement for a woman in her mid-30s. In April 1930, she was co-opted as a member of the Central Women's Advisory Committee for the year. This group of 6, chaired by the Countess of Ivor, included Mrs. Davidson, later Lady Davidson and a future MP, and Mrs. Cheeseman. 1931 would be Irene's breakthrough year. Here she is with her volunteer driver, Dolly Sanderson, and the car funded by Sir Cecil. And I think I'm right in saying we have one of the horseshoes in her papers, somewhat faded, but still there. One of the 16 women Conservative parliamentary candidates, compared to 36 for Labour, 6 for the, compared to 36 for Labour, 6 for the Liberals and 4 for other parties. She fought in one of the only 2 all-women contests, the other being with Thelma Cazalet and Leah Manning in Islington. Her Labour opponent in her new constituency at War's End on Tyne was the first ever woman cabinet minister, Margaret Bonfield, the Minister for Labour. Dame Irene's papers include 2 later undated accounts of her recollections of the 1931 success. Victory had seemed impossible as War's End hadn't returned a Tory since 1910. Margaret Bonfield had been, I quote, a patronising opponent, never visualising defeat, unquote. Her confidence that War's End was in the bag meant that she campaigned in other constituencies for Labour. The lesson Irene Ward took from this was never to be overconfident. Margaret Bonfield had infuriated Irene and her supporters by ringing up her agent to suggest joint appearances. Irene viewed this as a move to diminish her stature and create a sense of unreality in what was a serious contest. So she made what she called a gloves-off speech to show that she wasn't an incidental obstacle to Margaret Bonfield's success. And then, as she said, the campaign of its own accord came to life. After Margaret Bonfield died, Irene Ward paid tribute to her in the House of Commons in June 1953, describing her as a formidable political opponent. They battled it out again in the 1935 general election. Courageous as a minister, and she maintained her high office with dignity. She was a power in the woman's world. After Irene's 1931 success, letters and telegrams of congratulation poured in from the northeast and beyond. Sir Cecil Cochrane was filled with the emotion of the moment. He would die happy having seen the realisation of his last ambition. Even those who hardly knew her were moved to write warmly. A letter of congratulation from Helen Atkinson in Hammersmith described how she'd heard her debate in the Women's Service House with 2 other ladies on why you should join my party. Quote, as an old suffragette, I took a keen interest in this debate and could not but conclude your exposition be much the most masterly. It showed a breadth of view in dealing with the political situation and a superb marshalling of facts, which won my admiration. She congratulated her, and your party also, as I'm sure you're a capital acquisition to it. Dame Irene's undated, possibly post-war account of the declaration of the result and the cheering crowds which later greeted her is too lengthy to read here. But many years later, she recalled the impact of overhearing a beggar thank God that she got in. She resolved to never let these people down, and to know she would tackle unemployment was a wonderful feeling, she said. And this is Dame Irene's again undated assessment of the 1931 intake of women MPs. The unlimited potential of friends and ease with which Conservative women were absorbed into Parliament was to her a delightful memory. The new Conservative women never discussed their position as women. There was a tacit, though never pre-arranged, understanding that entitled them to join the smoke room, though they never did. But she acknowledged that this self-denying audience placed them at a disadvantage. Reputations, in high circles especially, were made or marred by the smoke room, an informality which helps to back a course or interest a minister, or just generally be aware of wider developments. And I think this is really stunning, this final comment. In the women's room, politics had been taboo. Lady Astor was the first woman to take her seat in Parliament in 1919, having won it after her husband very reluctantly vacated it on accession to his father's title. In 1931, she lost no time in inviting the new women Conservative MPs to a celebratory lunch in the House of Commons on the 10th of November. Her congratulatory telegram to Irene included the sentence, "I rejoice that at last we have plenty of the right kind of women." And here we have 12 of them. And the ones that I'm talking about today, Irene, of course, is the front row second right. And also in this afternoon's narrative, there's Mary Ada Pickford to her left, Lady Iva sits two seats to her right, Lady Astor, of course, back row, Mavis Tate, third left, and Thelma Caslett, centre. Florence Horsburgh is end of the back row. Irene and Lady Astor would go on to work together in campaigns for equal pay for women and women's rights in the Indian constitution. During Professor, now Sir Brian Harrison's interview with Dame Irene in 1977, a copy of which is now in the Women's Library, she recalled Lady Astor's kindness and good sense of humour. But while she would agree with him that Lady Astor was adept at bringing women together, she couldn't endorse her techniques in the House. The constant interruptions, perhaps forgetting she herself had been known at the time to fling questions at ministers and laugh off at the Speaker's reprimand. And she would have preferred Lady Astor not to ring up Conservative ministers with whom she, Irene, was having difficulties to tell him what to do. Professor Harrison, and remember this is the 1970s, perhaps hoping to elicit some sense of feminist solidarity, suggested that Lady Astor's networking skills, the way she brought women together with other politicians and reformers, must have been useful. But, interestingly, Dame Irene demurred, recalling a lunch attended by an unusually quiet George Bernard Shaw. Now this, and a point in another interview in which she criticised the dress code for women MPs, modelled on the black suit and white blouse adopted by Lady Astor to avoid trivial comments about appearance, offer further insights into Dame Irene's personality. There was a strong individualist streak which rebelled at constraints and manipulations. In the instance of the white blouse, it was for practical reasons. As she had told Lady Astor, London smog meant a daily change of blouse. And she might have added, but didn't, not all women MPs had the equivalent resources of St. James's Square in Clifton. With the power lunches, it wasn't that Dame Irene was antisocial. It was more their hybrid and to her artificial nature. As she told Harrison, her mind didn't work well in such situations. In her maiden speech in the House of Commons in May 1932,
during the debate on the coal mines bill, the closing of uneconomic mines because of surplus output, Irene criticised the failure to guarantee miners' wages. As the MP for War's End, she would have seen the consequences at first hand. During the next 7 years, Irene Ward would become one of the two most frequent speakers from the 1931 intake of women MPs, Florence Horsburgh being the other. Her impressive mastery of what were judged tough, masculine topics, heavy industries like shipbuilding, mining and engineering, regional unemployment and economic development, though not unique among women MPs, and her warm, enthusiastic can-do spirit seen here, this is a jolly Irene, the ships in the background suggest it's War's End, and to the right, instilling trust and confidence, her 1935 general election photograph. And Irene at Westminster in April 1933, on a smokeless coal steam wagon, giving a speech in support of miners and English coal. These must surely have contributed to her victory in the 1935 general election. It was a great personal success against the national trend for her party. Many of her male colleagues in the North lost their seats, and nationally the number of Conservative women MPs was reduced to 6. But Irene Ward was not just an assiduous constituency MP. In the summer of 1936, she made her second visit to Germany. Her first had been in the autumn of 1932 with a delegation of women MPs under the auspices of the German Economic and Political Society. The group had comprised Thelma Cazalet, now probably Irene's closest parliamentary friend, Florence Horsburgh, Mary Ada Pickford, and Mrs. Helen Brown Shaw. As part of their study of industrial conditions, the group were also officially welcomed in Berlin. The 1935 visit to Germany appears to have been part of an extensive solo speaking tour covering 7,000 miles in 4 months. From Berlin, she travelled under the British Council banner to the Baltics and Finland as a sort of goodwill ambassador. She continued on to France, Hungary, Yugoslavia and Czechoslovakia. Her main topics were how the British govern, British women in politics and self-government in the empire. At Westminster, she contributed to the 1935 Government of India Bill, with Lady Astor, Mary Ada Pigfoot, and the independent MP Eleanor Rathbone. Irene Ward piloted several amendments through the bill's committee stage to improve the rights of women under the Constitution. Irene had pressed for support through the Conservative associations and proposed 2 amendments in the government's name. After Irene's election success in November, Marjorie Green, Secretary of the National Council for Equal Citizenship, wrote that we remember with special gratitude your support of the Indian women's franchise, but adding and admitting you would have liked to have seen both you and Miss Bonfield in Westminster. Irene was also one of a small cross-party band of women MPs who criticised the national government's policy towards the Spanish Civil War. With Eleanor Rathbone, Ellen Wilkinson and Megan Lloyd-George, she served in a committee dealing with the evacuation of children in 1937-8. Her most significant contribution, however, during her interwar career, and the measure she remained most proud of in later life, was the 1938 amendment to the 1937 Poor Law Act. One of 8 bills introduced by women between 1919 and 39, this private member's bill, introduced under the 10-minute rule, provided local authorities could pay old age pensioners over 65 living in poor law institutions with pocket money of 2 shillings a week. That's about £3.70 in recent money. One of the most moving letters in Dame Irene's papers is one written and signed, rather shakily, by 7 signatories from the Staines Poor Law Institution in Ashford, Middlesex, in July 1938. It was, they wrote, a godsend to many in here, whose dark clouds overhang them, have now changed to a silver lining. They thanked her for her kindness and interest. We cannot express too much our gratitude to you. And this measure was at the later the basis for paying part of any pension to hospital patients and similar.
During the Second World War, Irene was actively involved in committees and campaigns addressing women's employment, inequality in compensation for injury as civilians, and pay between men and women. She chaired the Women's Power Committee, established in 1940 after the British Federation for Business and Professional Women lobbied Lady Astor and others for action on women's deployment, and this led into the Campaign for Equal Pay. She also sat on the Offshoot Committee, linked to a wider group of women's organisations. She served on the Women's Consultative Committee, created by the Minister of Labour, Ernie Bevin, in 1941. For both Irene Ward and Thelma Cazalet, now Cazalet Keir, in 1939 she married the writer David Keir, membership of the Women's Power Committee enhanced their influence in the Tory Reform Group, which supported the 1942 Beveridge Report, and the Conservative Women's Reform Group. Irene was in demand as a speaker. Between August 1943 and February 1944, she undertook the arduous, indeed perilous, mission to travel to China, India, and the Middle East for the Ministry of Information to explain the British war effort. And after France was liberated, she was dispatched there too. I'll explain the ladder in a moment. After her defeat in July 1945 general election, Labour landslide, the official speaking tours and visits may have helped to ease the temporary exile from parliamentary life. In Germany and Palestine, she toured camps for displaced persons, and with Thelma Cazalet Keir attended the Nuremberg trials. By 1948, she'd been adopted for the constituency of Tynemouth. Ironically, it now included Whitley Bay, seen of her 1923 dismissal for being just a woman. Returned to Parliament in the 1950 general election, defeating the incumbent Grace Coleman, Irene was soon back in the throes of the Equal Pay for Women campaign. Among her objectives was the formation of an all-party committee to secure equal pay. She helped draft an amendment to the King's speech to Parliament in March 1950, regretting the absence of mention of equal pay in government service. Another of her proposals was an international delegation of women MPs to lobby the International Labour Organization on pay in 1951. At Westminster, questioning ministers elicited details of the extent of equal pay for women civil servants. In May 1952, the House debated Charles Pannell's proposal, seconded by Douglas Houghton, in favour of equal pay for equal work. Houghton's later motion, in 1953, attracting an amendment by Irene. With other high-profile members of the Equal Pay Campaign Committee, Eleanor Summerskill and Barbara Castle, she maintained pressure on the government. Outside Parliament, pressure was also building up. 1954's mass meeting and a petition with 80,000 signatures submitted to coincide with the Commons debate on equal pay. 1955 brought a victory of sorts, but also the disbanding of the Equal Pay Campaign Committee. The notion of equal pay for women civil servants, non-industrial, was accepted, but implementation was to be rolled out over 7 years. Women teachers had to wait until 1961. Barbara Castle's much more comprehensive Equal Pay Act wasn't achieved until 1970. In the summer of 1952, Irene took the battle for equal pay to the offices of Parliament itself, when she championed, and eventually won, after a protracted struggle, the case of the first woman Hansard reporter, Mrs. Jean Winder. Appointed in 1944 as a temporary reporter on £400 per year, the same as the minimum rate for men, the problem arose after the war when she joined the permanent staff and was transferred to a differential scale, but at the same point on the men's minimum wage. Irene was particularly incensed by the change in the stance of ministers and others since the Conservatives had returned to office, reneging on an earlier support for Mrs. Winder. Throughout the rest of 1952 and much of 1953, Irene doggedly persisted, even clashing with the new speaker in the process. In August 1953,
The parliamentary commissioners finally agreed that Mrs. Wilder should be paid the same maximum rate as the men and backdated to the 1st of July. Her future pay to mirror any revisions in the men's grade. Irene's successful push for women to work in the House of Commons Library included walking through the House carrying a ladder to undermine arguments which had been advanced against the move, the idea that they couldn't climb ladders to hand down books. And I've included this ladder because I think she might approve. From 1955, women were eligible to work in the library. The 1950s saw the second of Dame Irene's private members bill pass into legislation. Her 1954 rights of entry, gas and electricity bill protected householders' rights over access requirements of the nationalised utilities. In 1955, the year she became a Dame of the British Empire, her account of the Women's Transport Service, WTS, was published. Created from the first aid nursing yeomanry, hence the book's title, Fainy Invicta, the WTS was the parent union for many of the women also recruited into the Special Operations Executive during the war. Why Dame Irene wrote the book is unclear. Perhaps she was encouraged to do so by Mary Baxter Ellis, the head of WTS, or the interest may have stemmed from her own nursing experience in the First World War, or her 1940s work with the Women's Consultative Committee, which brought her into contact with the Foreign Office and the Ministry of Economic Warfare. We may never know the origin of Dame Irene's passing reference in one of her many letters from 1956 onwards, arguing for an official history of SOE, that she had known many agents, including some who had met their deaths. But we do know that the barriers presented to Dame Irene accessing wartime records for her book informed another of her major campaigns. And here is Dame Irene, a victor of the 1959 general election, ready for her next big campaign. The photograph includes three of the key figures from the earlier Equal Pay Campaign Committee, Barbara Castle, back row, fifth from the right, and seated second left, Dr. Edith Summerskill. Dame Irene, standing end of the row, holding one of her less capacious handbags. The fourth, Thelma Cazalet Keir, was defeated in the 1945 general election. Megan Lloyd George, seventh left of a back row, had also promoted women's interest issues during the war. Dame Irene's belief that her unstinting lobbying convinced Prime Minister Harold Macmillan to authorise an exploratory study in 1960 and ultimately the commissioning of MRD Foote to write the official history of SOE in France, finally published nearly a decade later, has since been reassessed. Research in the National Archives by Dr. Christopher Murphy in 2003 revealed that while the Foreign Office was initially dismissive of her, by 1960 they began to see advantages in her campaign. An official history would counter the increasing number of American and Russian accounts, which marginalised British involvement with the European resistance movements, as well as tackle domestic critics, such as Elizabeth Nicholas and Jean Overton Fuller, who in the 1950s published works about SOE operations and the deaths of women agents. I'm grateful to Oliver House, the cataloguer of Dame Irene's papers, for drawing this article to my attention. For if it reduces her role in the commissioning of the official history, it underscores her ability, most evident in her campaigning for the equal pay, to catch the currents of history. And I also can't help wondering if the Foreign Office would have been quite so dismissive of Dame Irene if she had been a man. In the mid-1950s, Dame Irene acquired the reputation as an unruly fighter, Manchester Guardian, 1955. It held true for the remainder of her career, reaching its apogee in May 1968, when she disrupted parliamentary business to protest against the guillotining of the finance bill before she could raise issues on the impact in the Northeast. Banned from the House for 5 days, she was escorted from the chamber. Less dramatically, these were the years of her appointment to the Public Accounts Committee in 1964, her third and fourth private members' bills, the Nurses Amendment Act 1951, which to do with the training of assistant nurses, and the Penalties for Drunkenness Act 1962, amending that of 1872. She continued to campaign for service widows and others on small fixed incomes, and championing, albeit unsuccessfully, the Carl Rosa touring opera in its battles with the Arts Council. And as always, Northeast issues, especially housing and industry, claimed her attention. And here we have Dame Irene on the 1960 parliamentary visit to Russia, engaged in conversation, a female interpreter just out of sight. In 1959, she made a point of remarking that very few women had ever been sent on parliamentary commission overseas, so I think they took notice and sent her off to Russia. She came back, of course. The middle image is from the Commonwealth parliamentary tour to New Zealand, and bottom left, a weekend guest, probably at Thelma Caslett Keir's house in Kent, and Ted Heath to her left. While researching the Oxford DNB article I wrote on Baroness Castle for her recollections of working with Dame Irene on the Equal Pay campaign, Barbara remembered Dame Irene as someone easy to respect but difficult to get to know. I also wrote to Baroness Thatcher, asking if Dame Irene had supported young women MPs, rather as Lady Astor had. I got a really surprisingly long letter from Baroness Thatcher, and this is an extract. Irene made a great impression on all of us parliamentary candidates at our London meetings because she was such a tremendous personality. She was extremely practical in any proposal she put forward, and whenever she got up to speak, everyone, underlined, listened. I remember particularly that she regarded herself as an MP for those who lived on small fixed incomes. Irene was the perfect example of how a Member of Parliament should represent his or her constituency. So, how should we remember Dame Irene Ward, Baroness of North Tyneside, today? A Doughty parliamentarian, certainly. A campaigner against injustice wherever she encountered it. Competitive, courageous, impetuous, forceful, passionate, sympathetic. A consistent champion of her Northeast and the backbencher's role, pursuing the latter at the cost of her own wish to be a junior minister, knowing that she was far too independent to be accepted. Sometimes, too, a tad over the top. In her prime, a magnetic speaker, throughout her long career, she generated enthusiasm for the task in hand. She believed that the home should be the centre of a woman's life, but not its boundaries, though she never made a home for herself. Instead, she poured her life into her constituencies and into Parliament, a remarkable and a redoubtable figure. Thank you.